Everything we know about the giant squid, Architeuthis, comes from animals washed up on rocks or beaches. And some of the most interesting information has been obtained from the calcareous pieces of the ear and the statoliths.
A small fragment that has revealed a surprising piece of information. The Architeuthis is the animal with the highest rate of growth in the animal kingdom.
This calcareous piece of around 2 millimeters in length increases in growth daily. If we cut the statolith or polish its outer faces, we would see a series of rings starting from the nucleus, and each one of these rings is a daily increase.
Thanks to these statoliths, we now know that these squid grow around 1 centimeter a day, which rapidly turns the tiny larvae into the largest invertebrates on Earth. And as the detective work progresses, each new discovery in the bodies found helps us to approach the challenge of entering the world of the Kraken and trying to see it alive.
One of the most important pieces of information the bodies of Architeuthis have provided us with is their diet. They feed essentially on fish and cephalopods. They capture these prey with large tentacles whose ends are in the form of clubs. On the central part of these clubs, on the hands, they have powerful suckers, and on these suckers there are rings, chitinous toothed rings. Once the prey are held by these structures, from which it is virtually impossible to free themselves, they are transported by the tentacles to the mouth. There, two powerful jaws, an upper and a lower one, chitinous and with sharp edges, cut them up, and with the help of a rough tongue, the radula, they are swallowed. We scientists have learned much from the study of the bodies of the giant squid, but a single image of these animals alive in their natural environment would provide us with incredible information.
If we have not been able to see the giant squid alive, it is because its habitat is the depths of the ocean at between 300 and 1,500 meters. Down there, the pressure is tremendous. Where on the surface we are subject to one atmosphere equivalent to 1 kilogram per square centimeter, at a depth of 1,000 meters, that pressure is multiplied by 100. It is a crushing world shrouded in perpetual darkness. Very little food reaches it from the surface, and strange hunters lie in wait, armed with terrible weapons, large mouths and sharp fangs to ensure none of the scarce prey escape in the darkness. Adaptation to this extreme world has generated strange beings, disconcerting forms which to our eyes are easily converted into monsters. This universe without frontiers, where perpetual darkness reigns and the pressure is crushing, was the world in which we wanted to place our cameras in search of the legendary squid. A challenge which required meticulous preparation and specialized equipment. We had spent just over a year planning the campaign on paper. Now, long months of work lay ahead of us to materialize all the technical devices and means which would enable us to submerge our cameras into the depths of Carrandi in Asturias. The countdown had begun. We had the advice of specialists in submarine technology and also counted on the collaboration of expert biologists from the Marine Research Institute and the National Natural Science Museum. On board the two oceanographic ships, the Investigador and the Científico, we spent long weeks checking the water tightness, the resistance, and the sensitivity of special cameras capable of recording in the extreme conditions of pressure and darkness of the ocean depths. Time was running out. We wanted to undertake the campaign at the end of the summer, and the Cantabrian Sea was not an easy place in which to work. While we checked the stability and flotability of the buoys designed to carry the cameras, our chief engineer, Joaquin de Gracia, made the final adjustments to the key element in our campaign, a case specially designed for the Kraken Project. Inside it, a sophisticated system would make it possible to record continuously for the 15 days of the campaign the images captured by the submarine cameras and store them on a series of hard drives. The complexity of the system was due to the fact that it had to have a total autonomy, a decisive factor in the campaign. The case would remain inside a floating buoy and would be connected by a thick optic fiber cable to the structure carrying the camera, a structure with an adjustable lighting system, infrared lights, and different acoustic and optical signals which would serve as lures. The buoy and the camera system, whose nerve center was the recording case, would be autonomous and would be regulated from our ships. And to cover the search area we had chosen, we had three similar sets of equipment which defined an equilateral triangle inside which we would move around with our ships. Day finally came. On board the ships Investigador and Científico, belonging to the company Investigaciones Marinas, we set sail for the Carrandi fishing ground. We are not alone on our adventure. In order to carry out the campaign, we had requested an exclusion zone to keep the study area free from maritime traffic, and the patrol boat Mauro of the Spanish Navy accompanied us to guarantee compliance with this. Finally, 2 years after we had first considered the idea, we were setting off in search of the legendary giant squid. The first mission of the campaign consisted of carrying out a bathymetry which would enable us to establish the points chosen for the positioning of our cameras. At 43 degrees 56 seconds north and 5 degrees 29 seconds west, we located the so-called Pozo de la Vaca, a narrowing of the submarine canyon where we would place the three cameras at depths of 800, 700, and 500 meters, respectively. Now we were sailing over the Carrandi Trench, the territory of the enigmatic Kraken. The Carrandi Trench, less than 30 kilometers from the coast of Asturias, sharply falls to unfathomable depths, down to over 3,000 meters. At the start of its drop from the continental platform, Carrandi forms underwater canyons along which the currents drag large amounts of nutrients on which enormous shoals of small fish feed. And these, in turn, attract the large predators, among them the giant squid. And here in the so-called Pozo de la Vaca, the land relief enabled us to locate the three cameras in different substrata and at different depths within the influence of one of these currents. If designing, constructing, and testing the cameras was a complex task, positioning them at the chosen places represented a truly formidable challenge. The structure of the buoys, ballasted with a dead weight of 3,000 kilos, weighed over 5 tons, and the Cantabrian Sea does not make things easy. Finally, having stabilized the anchor of the first buoy, the time came to send one of our cameras into the depths of the ocean. The air was thick with emotion. We were going to open a window onto an unknown world which no one had ever seen. As the camera descended, the optic fiber umbilical cord that joined it to the buoy indicated the depth of descent. We positioned this first one at 700 meters on one of the walls of the underwater canyon. Now all we had to do was wait for the signal, which would reach us live and by radio from the first buoy that was already freely floating above the Carrandi trench.